أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط. صدق الله العظيم.
الحمد لله، الحمد لله وكفى، والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا ايها الذين امنوا لا تاكلوا اموالكم بينكم بالباطل الا ان تكون تجاره عن تراض منكم ولا تقتلوا انفسكم ان الله كان بكم رحيما ومن يفعل ذلك عدوانا وظلما فسوف نصليه نارا وكان ذلك على الله يسيرا. صدق الله العظيم. Now in these two ayat, two fundamentals of human society are being discussed. The solidarity and peace of human society depends upon two things: respect of each other's life and respect of each other's property. This mutual respect between human beings actually is the cornerstone of the social order. The society will be strong and there will be peace and tranquility in this society if all people have mutual respect among them for each other's life, for each other's property. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu la ta'kulu amwalakum bainakum bil batil. These words appeared in Suratul Baqarah also, in the 23rd section. The last ayah is وَلَا تَأْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بِالْبَاطِلِ وَتُضْلُوا بِهَا إِلَى الْحُكَّامِ لِتَأْكُلُوا فَرِيقًا مِنْ أَمْوَالِ النَّاسِ بِالْإِسْمِ وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. Now the first part is the same. لَا تَأْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بِالْبَاطِلِ. Don't eat your properties among yourselves through false means, wrongfully. This is your property, this is my property. This is my money, this is your money. I am not entitled to get it from you, you are not entitled to get it from me. Illa an takuna tijaratan an taradin minkum. Except that it should be a trading between you with mutual consent. This trading, you know, I have purchased this thing for $1, I am offering to sell it for $2, and he knows it. This is the price that I am taking, that I went to the wholesale market, bought it, brought it to this outlet, retail outlet. So you are giving me $1, but you are giving it with your consent. So if there is consent, I have taken $1 from you, but this is within a trading. وَلَا تَعْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بِالْبَاطِلِ. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَعْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بِالْبَاطِلِ إِلَّا أَن تَكُونَ تِجَارَةً عَنْ تَرَاضٍ مِنْكُمْ. وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. And don't kill yourselves. What does it mean? Nobody is going to kill himself, suicide. Don't kill each other, because you belong to one social order. You are all human beings. This human being is also your brother. If you are killing your brother, it means you are killing yourself. وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِكُمْ رَحِيمًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very merciful unto you. وَمَنْ يَفَلْ ذَلِكَ عُدْوَانًا وَظُلْمًا. Whosoever does so, any of these two things, zulman, rudwanan, transgressively, wa zulman, and wrongfully, fasawfa nuslihi nara, so soon we shall cast him into fire. Wa kana dhalik ala Allah yaseera, and this is very easy for Allah. Don't think it's very difficult for him. He will throw you into the fire. Don't think that Allah will hesitate from throwing you into the fire, because you have committed these big crimes. Now, as you must have been feeling yourself, that although these ayat which we are studying today, they are discussing with rules of conduct, then, you know, laws relating to different aspects of human life. But the language is not, you know, very dry legal language, no. After these, say, a few rules are given, few instructions, and then some ayat of wisdom, admonition, education, giving you deep insight into things. What is tawbah? Now that was not something pertaining to any legal thing. That is the philosophy of deen. That is the basics of the human morality. In the same way, you will find now a very basic question being discussed here about sins. That sins and contravention of the divine law is also of two types. Major sins, kabair, and smaller, minor sins, sagair. Now, there should be a balance. Neither it should happen that you are looking for and you are very cautious, very careful about the sagair, but some of the kabair you are committing. Well, that is absolutely wrong. So actually what should happen? First, what is more important should be looked after first. In tajtanibu kabaira ma tunhauna an. If you abstain and shun from those big crimes from which you are being prohibited, in tajtanibu, if you abstain from them, kabaira, the big sins, ma tunhauna anhu, from which you are being forbidden, nukaffir ankum sayyatikum, we shall acquit you of the smaller sins, the sagair, we shall pardon them, we shall condone them. وَنُدْخِلْكُمْ مُدْخَلًا كَرِيمًا, and we shall make you enter and admit you to the noble admittance, the place which is very noble and honorable. You will be admitted into the paradise. So this is the very basic thing, you know. People, you know, looking after very careful for minor things, but they're not taking any care of the major things. Whether somebody is doing this rafa'i again or not, oh, he is not doing it. So he is not saying the salah properly, but he is doing business with interest. No harm. Let it be so. So these are the things, you know, we have reversed this ratio proportion. We have to be very careful and very watchful for the kabair. And we should be lenient about the sagair. These small things, you know, we should have broad chests for each other. And we should accept the differences regarding those things. But about the major things, in tajtanibu kabaira ma tunhauna an, nukaffir ankum sayyatikum. These smaller sins, discrepancies, due to the human weaknesses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will condone them. وَلَا تَتَمَنَّوْ مَا فَضَّلِ اللَّهُ بِهِ بَعْضَكُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ. Now, the philosophy of family life is being discussed here. But the first ayah is very important. وَلَا تَتَمَنَّوْ, don't desire, مَا فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ بِهِ بَعْضَكُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ. Don't desire, don't covet that thing with which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has excelled some of you over the others. Now this is a very basic rule. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me something, has given you something else. He has given wealth to somebody, given wisdom to another one, given knowledge to another one. So these are the bounties of Allah, and Allah has given something to one and another thing to someone else. Now if I am jealous why he has been given this, this is wrong. Don't desire, don't covet. Be contented with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. You should have, you know, evaluate that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me this thing. Well, I should be contented with it. Now this is the preamble for what? The relationship between men and women. Allah has made men stronger than women, given them tougher bodies, the size of their physique, average physique of males is greater than the average physique of females. Average size and weight of brain of males is greater than the average size and weight of the brains of the females. So Allah has given something more to the males. Now if the females, you know, they are jealous, and they are not ready to accept this division that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made between them, and he has put the females in one aspect inferior to men, and the men superior to women, Well, one should accept what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. It is His creation. وَلَا تَتَمَنَّوْ مَا فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ بِهِ بَعْضَكُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ لِلرِّجَالِ نَصِيبٌ مِمَّا كَسَبُوا مِمَّا اكْتَسَبُوا وَلِلنِّسَاءِ نَصِيبٌ مِمَّا اكْتَسَبْنَ. For men there is the portion from their own earnings. And in the same way women will get and deserve what they have earned. But the earning here doesn't mean, you know, what money you have earned, how many dollars you have earned. The earning in Quran is mostly for the good deeds or the bad deeds. You are earning good deeds for you. You are earning bad deeds for you. What does it say? What does it mean? As far as the moral level is concerned, men and women are absolutely equal. The moral position, now the honor, human dignity, human respect, equally shared by men and women. Morality equally shared by women and men. But you know, in this society, in this social order, in the institution of a family, now one has to be put over the other. Someone has to head the family. There cannot be two heads of an institution. The institution has to have one on the top. So that is actually the subject being discussed here. As far as the moral attitudes are concerned, you are earning for yourself and she is earning for herself. The good deeds, the virtues that she has earned, well, she will get the reward in the hereafter. And the virtues and the good deeds that you have earned, you will get the reward in the hereafter. وَلَا تَتَمَنَّوْ مَا فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ بِهِ بَعْضَكُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ لِلرِّجَالِ نَصِيبٌ مِمَّا اكْتَسَبُوا وَلِلنِّسَاءِ نَصِيبٌ مِمَّا اكْتَسَبْنَ وَاسْأَلُوا اللَّهَ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. You ask Allah from His bounty. If you see that Allah has given someone something more than you, you ask Allah, He will compensate you in some other way. Maybe He gives you something else. So you ask, وَاسْأَلُوا اللَّهَ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمًا. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. وَلِكُلِّنْ جَعَلْنَا مَوَالِيَ مِمَّا تَرَكَ الْوَالِدَانِ وَالْأَقْرَبُونَ. Now this is another appendix we may call to the law of inheritance. Again, you know, reminder. And for everyone we have fixed the inheritors from whatever is left by the parents or the relatives. To everyone we have appointed heirs of that which parents and near relatives leave. وَالَّذِينَ عَقَدَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ. As for those with whom you have some treaties, you have some, you know, friendship, bonds of friendship, فَآتُوهُمْ نَصِيبَهُمْ. You can give them whatever you like. You can give them their share, their portion, but during your lifetime. They can't inherit. And also, if you want to make a bequest, a wasiyah, you can make up to one third of your total property, not more than that. But you know, the strangers, your friends, maybe howsoever dear they are to you, they cannot inherit. They will not be the inheritors. Inheritance will go to the relatives about which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has fixed their portions and their shares. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدًا. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a witness over everything. Now comes that ayah. الرِّجَالُ قَوَّامُونَ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ. You know, the previous ayah, ayah number 32, was a tamheed, was a preamble to this ayah. Allah has made someone excellent, excel over the other in some respect. That was a general rule. Now this rule is applied to the family life. A man and a woman are equal. They equally share the dignity and the honor of being human beings. But when a woman agrees to be a wife to a man who is now a husband, now they are not equal. That is the difference. Men and women are equal, morally equal, being human beings equal. But now they are entering into an agreement. All human beings are equal. But one is employer, the other one is employee. Are they equal? No. One is the boss, other is the subordinate. Are they equal? No. They are not equal in management. They are equal as human beings. In the same way, males and females are equal. Morally equal. Being human beings, the dignity and honor as human beings equal. but as wives and husbands, not equal. Ar-rijalu qawwamuna 'alan nisaa. Men are the managers or the controllers or the protectors or the guardians or the rulers over women. قَوَّامُونَ عَلَى النِّسَىٰ. Now because this feminism these days, this is a philosophy, it's a culture going from West. It's going very speedily to the East now, spreading very speedily. And this is based on total equality of men and women in every respect. And this is the biggest blunder that West has created and which has ruined the family system altogether, broken it, just shattered it. And we are also proceeding, we are imitating the West and we are also following them. But you know, that is why some of the people, some of the mufassireen of today, they misinterpret this ayah. What is qama ala? I must discuss it in detail. Qama yakumo, just as you have the example in English, to give, it means something. To give up, means something else. To give in, absolutely different. So these prepositions, they change the meaning. Qama yakumo, to stand up. Stand up erect. Qama yakumo. Qama ila, to rise, to do something. Qama ila, he rose, and he intended to do something. Qama be, to manage something, to sustain something. Qama ala, to guard something, to control something, to direct something, to rule over something. So even the translation of rulers is not wrong. Because this qama ala, ala, as I told you, when Allah makes tawbah, it is ala. When a man makes tawbah, it is ilah. Tubu ilallah. Wallahu yatubu alaykum. So there is a hell of difference between ala and ilah. Qama ila, qama be, qama without any preposition, and qama ala. Ar-rijalu qawwamuna 'alan nisaa. Men are the rulers over women. They are the managers, you may call. They are the protectors, you may call. They are the guardians, you may call. The softest word you may use, but the harshest word is also not wrong. Men are the rulers. Husband is the ruler in the family. He is the head of the family. And if you don't accept the husband as the head of the family, the institution of family will go to docks. الرجال قوامون على النساء بما فضل الله بعضهم على بعض. In the same terminology. ولا تتمنوا ما فضل الله بعضكم على بعض. Now Quran, you know, it's, you know, regarding the passions and emotions of women, not saying clearly that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made men superior over women. No. بعضهم على بعض. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made someone superior over someone. So that is the general rule. But here, الرِّجَالُ قَوَّامُونَ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ, by dint of that, by which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made one superior over the other. وَبِمَا أَنفَقُوا مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ, and because of their spending their money. Because the husband is supporting the wife. The husband is the bread earner of the family. The head of the family has to support the family. When he goes to marry a woman, he offers bridal money, dowry. Why? The woman also needs the husband. And as husband needs a wife, they are equal. Both the sexes, they need the opposite sex. Why should the man pay the dowry? Why should a woman pay the dowry? No. This is the whole system, you know, it's logical. Because the man has to have the upper hand. Because he is to become the qawwam. So he must, as if he is the seeker. And actually woman agrees to have, to go into his nikah, to into his hisn, as we have noted, hisn, muhsanat, going to the, into the fortress of that husband, that man's nikah and marriage. So this, that is why, because they are spending, they give the door or the dowry or the bridal money, that they have to support. That is why now they are rijal, they are the qawwamun. Ar-rijalu qawwamun 'ala an-nisaa bima fadallahu ba'dahum 'ala ba'd. Now this is the basic philosophy of family life in Islam. Unless you accept the basic philosophy under the Western influence. Now you know, you can distort the meanings, take it this way or that way, but it won't help. We must accept Quran as it is, and it is logical, absolutely logical. فَالصَّالِحَاتُ Now, what should be the attitude of a pious woman? So the righteous women are those. Now note, what are the qualities of a righteous wife in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? فَالصَّالِحَاتُ قَانِتَاتٌ They are obedient to their husbands. قَانِتَات قُنُوت Obedience. That is the first quality. What does it mean? You can argue with your husband. You can bring him to your point of view by arguing, by appealing, whatsoever it is. But if in the end the husband says, no, this is my opinion, you have to give in. You have to accept. The woman has to accept the decision of the husband. Except if he is going beyond the limits of the Sharia. لا تعطى لمخلوق في معصية الخالق. This is the rule. No one among the makhluq, among the creatures, will be obeyed in anything in which there is some disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator. He is the absolute, he deserves the absolute obedience, total obedience. But within the limits of the obedience of Allah, you have to obey. The women have to obey their husbands. The children have to obey their parents. The subordinates have to obey their bosses. The general public has to obey the rulers. And so on. There is obedience. There can be no social order without obedience. But there is a limit to the obedience in Islamic society. Within the limits of the Sharia, nobody can demand obedience, total obedience, irrespective of the limits of the Sharia. No. Then he becomes a god himself. It is shirk. It becomes associating someone equal and partner to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَانِتَاتٌ حَافِظَاتٌ لِلْغَيْبِ And they are who guard in the absence or in the secret, the unseen. I will let you know what does it mean. There is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. حَافِظَاتٌ لِلْغَيْبِ بِمَا حَفِظَ اللَّهِ Which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guarded. There is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam which says, Which is the best wife? What are the qualities of best wife? And he said, the best wife is the one who pleases you when you see her, who obeys your orders, number two, qanitatun, and who guards your property and her own honor in your absence from home. She is the custodian of your property, your maal, your belongings at home. You have gone out to work. Now she is the custodian. She has to guard your property. Number two, when she has agreed to be a wife to you, now her honor and chastity is also a trust with her. It is your property now. You have the right. The conjugal rights you have over her. So actually this is also a trust. She has to guard it. حَافِظَاتٌ لِلْغَيْبِ She has to guard her own honor because now that belongs to the husband. She has agreed to be a wife to that person. And the property that is in her custody in the absence of the man who is going out for work. فَالصَّالِحَاتُ قَانِتَاتٌ حَافِظَاتٌ لِلْغَيْبِ بِمَا حَفِظَ اللَّهِ وَاللَّاتِي تَخَافُونَ نُشُوزَهُنَّ As for those about whom you fear insubordination. Nushuz. She wants to go her own way, not obey. You may like it or dislike it. I have to do it. If that is the attitude, now what to do? وَاللَّاتِ تَخَافُونَ نُشُوزَهُنَّ فَعِزُوهُنَّ Number one, admonish them. Try to persuade them to mend their ways. وَاجُرُوهُنَّ فِي الْمَضَاجِعِ Number two, leave them alone in their beds. Don't have any relationship, any sexual relationship with them. Keep yourself away from their beds, or keep them away from your beds. And even if this is not sufficient, وَضْرِبُوهُنَّ You can beat them also. Now these are the words of Allah. I can't say anything. Maybe it is not palatable for the Western people, Western society. But if you want to keep a discipline, the right of punishment should be there. Otherwise, there can be no discipline. There can be no order. The punishment should be there. This house, this family, is the institution, basic unit of this society. Whatever will be in this basic unit, it will spread to the whole of this society. If there is anarchy, indiscipline, the whole society will become anarchist and without any discipline. Loose. If there is discipline in the family, then the whole society will be disciplined or organized. So these are the three words. فَعِزُوهُنَّ Admonish them. وَهْجُرُوهُنَّ فِي الْمَضَاجِ Number two, keep away from them. Leave them alone in their beds. وَضْغِبُوهُنَّ And you can beat also. But the Prophet said, don't slap her. Don't inflict anything on her body that leaves some, you know, effect, permanent effect. These are the cautions that you have to do. To take and observe. وَضْغِبُوهُنَّ فَيْنَتَعْنَاكُمْ But now if they mend their ways, and now if they are ready to obey you, فَلَا تَبْغُوا عَلَيْهِنَّ سَبِيلًا Now don't try to find lame excuses to punish them more and more. Only till such time that they have mended their attitude, you can give these three types of punishments. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلِيًّا كَبِيرًا Verily Allah is exalted one and the greatest. Because He is the exalted one. If you are doing it wrongfully to your wives, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take you to task. You are also answerable. As you have to keep the discipline in your family, Allah wants to keep the discipline in the whole of humanity. So you will be punished. You will be answerable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ شِقَاقَ بَيْنِهِمَا Now, if the relationship between the wife and the husband are strained, شِقَاق, a breakup between them, a breach of relationship between them. إِنْ خِفْتُمْ If you are afraid of a break or breach in their relationship, فَبْعَسُوا حَكَمًا مِّنْ أَهْلِهِ So appoint one arbiter from the family of the husband, ahlihi, وَحَكَمًا مِّنْ أَهْلِهَا And one arbiter from the family or people of the wife. إِنْ يُرِيدَ إِصْلَاحَا If both of them, they intend to mend the ways and effect a reconciliation, يُوَفِّقُ اللَّهُ بَيْنَهُمَا Allah Ta'ala will bring about a reconciliation between them. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلِيمًا خَبِيرًا Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all-knowing and He is aware of everything. Now, behind this ayah, you know, the background is that sometimes the relationship is strained. Wife also wants to keep this relationship. The husband also wants. But something has sprung up, you know. Now she is not also ready to bend and he is also not ready to bend. In such a case, although both don't want to separate. None of them wants the divorce. But you know, to keep your nose upwards, so you feel ashamed. Why should I admit my fault? Why shouldn't he admit his fault? That is going on. Now, if there are arbiters, they can arrange a reconciliation. And this, if they actually want a reconciliation, this appointment of arbiters is an easy way for effecting a reconciliation between the spouses. Now, there is a very profound ayah. The basics of Islam, the faith, the deen. وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا Number one, worship and obey Allah and Allah alone. And don't associate anybody with Him. Anything with Him. If you accept anybody else as absolute, as having the right of absolute obedience, مُطَاعِ مُطْلَقْ You have made him equal to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you love anyone, anything, as you love Allah, you have made him equal to Allah. So all these forms of shirk, you know, I have a detailed lecture in English also, 2 hours, over the kinds and different forms of shirk. وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا Number one, be a bondsman to Allah and don't associate anything with him. Don't take anything equal with him. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا Be gentle and kind to your parents. وَبِذِي الْقُرْبَى And in the same way, be gentle and kind to your relatives, close in relationship. Wal yatama, and to the orphans. Wal masakin, and the needy, the destitutes, the poor people. Wal jari zil qurba, and the neighbor who is also a relative. Two things have, you know, come together. He's a relative also and a neighbor also, next door neighbor. Wal jari junubi, then the neighbor who is not a relative, alien, who is alien, who is not from your family, but he is the neighbor. So there is, he has rights over you. Wasaib bil jamb. And anybody who is at your side, you are traveling in a train, somebody is sitting along with you. He becomes a temporary neighbor. He has a rights over you. In a bus, riding a bus, or anywhere else. Whosoever is sitting by your side becomes a temporary neighbor. So three types of neighbors. A neighbor, permanent neighbor, and he is a relative also. First of all, his rights. Then a neighbor who is a permanent neighbor, who lives by your side, but he is alien. Then number three, a temporary neighbor, was sahib bil jamb. Wabni sabil. And in the same way, the travelers, the wayfarers, wama malakat aymanukum. And in the same way, be gentle and kind to your slaves and slave girls. Don't treat them harshly. The Prophet had said, if you have given some task to them, you help them so that they should feel that only I am not required to do this hard task. My master is also partaking in it. So actually then their emotions, you know, they will be soothed. And eat, whatever you eat, you feed them also. Whatever you wear, the clothings, the same clothing you have to give to your slaves. These are the wordings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Muslims acted upon it. And that was the way by which this you know, these slaves were emancipated. They became equal to Muslims in some time, you know. It was only a matter of time. And you know there was a time in Muslim history when the biggest kingdoms, they were ruled by slaves. The Mamalik in Egypt, the Khandane Ghulama in India, they were the Mamluks, they were the slaves, but they rose to that position. Many of our Aimma, the biggest alims, Muhaddiseen, Fuqaha, they are from the slaves. And you know, even the princes used to serve them. The sons of Harun al-Rashid used to quarrel with each other, Mamun and Amin, that I will set the shoes of my teacher right. And the others would say, no, this is my right, I will set the shoes right. And the teacher was a slave. So that is the emancipation. Inna Allah la yuhibbu man kana mukhtalan fakhura. Verily Allah Ta'ala doesn't like those people who are arrogant and boastful. Mukhtal, arrogant. Fakhur, boastful. Alladhina yabkhaluna wa yamuruna an-nasa bil bukhl. Whosoever is arrogant, he must be a bakhil also. He must be niggardly. He must be miserly. Because he is boastful. Why he is boastful? He has money, he has wealth. And he must keep the money with him. Because it is the source of pride that he has. So this is a logical relationship. Mukhtal and fakhur is necessarily niggardly and miserly. Allazina yabkhaluna wa yamuruna an-nasa bil bukhl. Who act miserly themselves, and they advise others also to be miserly and niggardly. Why are you spending? Keep the money with you. This will be a source of respect and honor in this society. Why are you giving it over to the poor or in charity? Keep it with you. الَّذِينَ يَبْخَلُونَ وَيَأْمُرُونَ النَّاسَ بِالْبُخْلِ وَيَكْتُمُونَ مَا آتَاهُمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. And they want to conceal and hide what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them out of His bounty. You know, they want to wear very shabby clothes. Why? Lest any beggar should ask, if I have a good clothing put on my body, well, somebody can come and ask for something, some alms and some charity. And if he sees he is also clothed in rags, you know, how can I go and ask for something from him? So they conceal the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you will find these Jews, you know, very shabby looking, and they are not dressed well, and they are millionaires. If you go to their shops and their businesses, you find that they are millionaires. So these things are, you know, this is not poetry. This is actually what happened in human society. الَّذِينَ يَبْخَلُونَ وَيَأْمُرُونَ النَّاسَ بِالْبُخْلِ وَيَكْتُمُونَ مَا آتَاهُمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ وَأَعْتَدْنَا لِلْكَافِرِينَ عَذَابًا مُهِينًا. And for such thankless people, here kafirin should not be translated as unbelievers. There is no question of unbelievers over here. It's all the issues are discussed about Muslims. Whosoever is thankless, because kufr means to conceal something. To conceal the truth of religion is kufr. To conceal the shukr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is again kufr. لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ وَلَإِنْ كَفَرْتُمْ إِنَّ عَذَابِي لَشَدِيدٌ. So kufr against Islam also and kufr against shirk also. بَالَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ الَّذِينَ يَبْخَلُونَ وَيَأْمُرُونَ النَّاسَ بِالْبُخْلِ وَيَكْتُمُونَ مَا آتَاهُمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ وَأَعْتَدْنَا لِلْكَافِرِينَ عَذَابًا مُهِينًا. And for such thankless people, we have prepared a chastisement, a punishment which is very humiliating, muheen, ihanat amiz. وَالَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ رِيَاءَ النَّاسِ. Now there is another category of wealthy people who spend their money. وَالَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ المعاملهم, they spend their money ريانناس, to show off to the people. Well, he does the acts of charity. He is a very good person. وَلَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَلَا بِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. And he doesn't really believe in Allah. And he doesn't believe really in the day of judgment, in the last day. Because if one believes in Allah, he will spend for the pleasure of Allah. If he believes in the day of judgment, he will spend and give alms and charity to get the reward of the day of judgment. But if he doesn't have the real faith, neither in Allah nor in the day of judgment, and now he is giving something in charity, he is only doing it to show off to the people that he is a very philanthropist and he is doing this public service. Maybe he has to contest some election, you know, in the near future. And for that purpose, he is distributing alms and charity and all these things. رِيَا النَّاسِ وَالَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ رِيَا النَّاسِ وَلَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَلَا بِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَنْ يَكُنِ الشَّيْطَانُ لَهُ قَرِينًا فَسَاءَ قَرِينًا. And for whomsoever shaitan becomes the comrade and colleague, he becomes the friend, قَرِين. So he is a very bad comrade and bad colleague. So what does it mean? They are the companions of shaitan, of Iblis. وَمَاذَا عَلَيْهِمْ. What harm could have come to them? What harm can come to them? لَوْ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. If they have real faith in Allah, real faith in the last day, وَأَنْفَقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقَهُمُ اللَّهِ. And on the basis of that real faith and conviction, iman in Allah and iman in the day of judgment and the hereafter, and they are spending for that purpose, مِمَّا رَزَقَهُمُ اللَّهِ, from whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon them, وَكَانَ اللَّهُ بِهِمْ عَلِيمًا. And Allah knows them very well. Knows who is spending for the pleasure of Allah. And knows who is spending for show-off. For only showing it to the people. Or to have some worldly rewards. To save some taxes from the government. A foundation has been established. What for? To save the taxes, you know. And to have some access to the centers of power. You can have a lobbying. And you can go to the congressmen and the senators, and you can go your own way, and you can get the decisions which are beneficial to you, and you are spending for charity. But actually your purpose is that. وَمَاذَا عَلَيْهِمْ لَوْ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَأَنْفَقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقَهُمُ اللَّهِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ بِهِمْ عَلِيمًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَظْلِمُ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to do any wrong to any person, even equal to the weight of a particle. People have translated it as an atom. But now this is the recent term. At the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when this Quran was being revealed, there was no concept of atom. Zarra, particle. Miskala zarra. Inna Allah la yazlamu miskala zarratin. Wa in taku hasanatan. Allah is not going to destroy any deed of any person, even if it be the weight of a particle. وَإِن تَكُ حَسَنَةً. If it is a good deed, يُضَاعِفْهَا. He will double it, multiply it. وَيُوتِ مِن لَدُنْهُ عَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. And in addition to giving the reward, so many folds, he will give the reward from his own. More he will add. فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جَيْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ. This is one of the most profound ayat of the Quran. And here you must relate it with the ayat of Surah Al-Baqarah. This shahadat ala al-nas. وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ وَيَكُونَ الرَّسُولُ عَلَيْكُمْ شَهِيدًا. And in that way we have made you the middle ummah or the best ummah, so that you become witnesses over the whole of humanity. And our Rasul, our messenger, becomes a witness over you, against you. He will testify on the day of judgment, O Allah, your words which came to me, I conveyed them to these people. They can't plead ignorance. I conveyed your message. This is the testimony that every Rasul will do. He will testify. Every messenger of Allah, when you know that ummah of that Rasul will be brought to the book for accountability. First of all, as a court witness, as a prosecution witness, the messenger who was sent to that ummah, he will stand up and testify, Oh Allah, I had preached and I had conveyed your message to these people. They can't plead ignorance. Now they are accountable for whatever they did. So this is the place and this is the position of the messengers of Allah. Now what will happen on that day? This is very important. فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جَيْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ. So what will be the condition? What will happen? When we shall raise from every ummah a witness. From every ummah. Moses will stand up. A witness against Bani Israel. I gave you the book that Allah gave to me. I practiced it myself. Showed you the example. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. Now you are responsible for what you did. And Jesus will stand up and he will say, I conveyed the message of Allah. In the same way, what will happen? O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we shall bring you forth to testify against these people. فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جَيْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ وَجَيْنَا بِكَ عَلَى هَاُولَاءِ شَهِيدًا. This هَاُولَاء is pointing towards whom? The people. The nation of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Bani Ismail, the people of Arabia, to whom he preached and conveyed the message personally. He himself conveyed the message. Jaina bika ala haulai shahida. And who were those haulai? They were the relatives. They are the kinsmen. They were from his own tribe. They were his own people. That is why the Prophet once wept over this ayah. A very important tradition. Once the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked Hazrat Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu ta'ala an, recite to me some Quran, some part of Quran. I want to listen it from you. He said, should I recite Quran unto you? It was revealed to you. And the Prophet said, yes. It gives me an extra pleasure to listen it from somebody else. Now complying with the directive of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud says, I started reciting Surah An-Nisa from the very beginning. Now just imagine, Sahaba are sitting, the Rasul is there sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you know, bowing his head down, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is reciting the ayat from the beginning of Surah An-Nisa, from where we started today. When he reached this ayah, فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جَيْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ وَجَيْنَا بِكَ عَلَى هَاُولَاءِ شَهِيدًا. The Prophet said, حَسْبُكْ حَسْبُكْ. Stop here, stop here. Let it be the end. And now when Abdullah ibn Mas'ud raised his head and saw, tears were flowing down the eyes of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I will have to testify against my own kith and kin. They will be thrown in the fire of hell before my eyes. My own uncles. Was not Abu Lahab the uncle of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The people of my own tribe. I will have to testify against them. فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جَيْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ وَجَيْنَا بِكَ عَلَى هَاُولَاءِ شَهِيدًا. يَوْمَئِذٍ يَبَدُّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَعَصَبُ الرَّسُولِ. On that day, people who have disbelieved and who have disobeyed the Messenger of Allah, they would very much wish, لَا تُصَوَّى بِهِمُ الْأَرْضِ, would be that earth is leveled with them. They are buried into down into the earth. Now, تُصَوَّى بِهِمُ الْأَرْضِ وَلَا يَكْتُمُونَ اللَّهَ حَدِيثًا, and they will not be able to conceal anything, to hide anything from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, any word. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَقْرَبُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَأَنْتُمْ سُكَارَى. Another instruction. Oh, you who believe, don't go near prayer. And according to some mufassireen, prayer places also. This is mosque, the place for prayers. Don't go near these mosques. In what condition? It is coming later. And don't go near the prayer itself. وَأَنْتُمْ سُكَارَى. When you are intoxicated. Now this is the second commandment regarding the use of liquor. The first was in Surah Al-Baqarah. يَسَلُونَ عَنِ الْخَبْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ قُلْ فِيهِمَا إِسْمٌ كَبِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ وَإِسْمُهُمَا أَكْبَرُ مِنْ نَفْعِهِمَا. There is some benefit also in this liquor. But you know the sin is greater. The evil in it is greater than the benefit that it has. Now that was the only instruction given. No final injunction that it is haram. The second comes here. When you have taken liquor and you are intoxicated, don't go near the prayer or the prayer place. Hatta ta'lamu ma taqulun. Till such time that you come to your back to your senses and you know what you are saying. Maybe if you are intoxicated, you stand to pray and you are saying something else because you don't understand what you are saying. You are not in your senses. So when that, you know, intoxication is gone and you now know what you are saying, then go to the prayer. Wala junubun, junuban. And also, when you are unclean due to the seminal discharge, whether that discharge is due to actual intercourse or any nightfall, anything else, if there is a discharge of seminal fluid, then you can't go near the salah and nor the masjid, nor the mosque. You can't enter it. You can't sit if you are in that unclean condition. Illa abiri sabilin. Except if you are traveler. If you have only to pass through the mosque, you don't want to sit here, that is permissible. You have to go from this side to that side, you can pass. In the same way, if you are a traveler and you don't find water, what to do? That is given up. Hatta taghtasilu. Until that time that you can wash your whole body, ghusl. This is necessary. Wa in kuntum marda, but there are exceptions, there are concessions. But if you are ill, sick, it is dangerous to take a bath. Aw ala safarin, or you are on a travel. You are on a journey, you don't find water. Aw jaa ahadun minkum min al-ghaib, or someone from you has come after answering the call of the nature. Aw lamastumun nisa, or you have had sexual contact with your wives. فَلَن تَجِدُوا مَاً, and in these conditions, if you don't find water, water is not available. فَتَيَمَّمُوا سَعِيدًا طَيِّبًا. So now, seek and find clean earth. Clean earth. فَمْسَحُوا بِوُجُوهِكُمْ وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ أَيْدِيكُمْ, and wipe with that earth your faces and your hands. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَفُوًا غَفُورًا. Verily, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forgiving and benign. Now this is the concession that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given. In place of wudu also, ablution. In place of ghusl, bath also. Both conditions. Whether the unclean condition is minor or major. Minor conditions are those in which you need wudu, ablution. Major condition is that in which you need a bath, total bath. But in both these conditions, if water is not available or you are sick, it's not advisable to take a bath, then tayammum would suffice. With clean earth, you wash or you, you know, just wipe your face and hands. Now this first part of this surah, 43 ayat, in which there was a positive discourse towards Muslims, what to do, how to organize yourself, how to reform your society, how to bring sex discipline into your society, how to bring justice, how to protect the rights of women, how to protect the rights of orphans, all these things, different aspects of social life, and so many other things also, they have been discussed here. Now a few ayat, these are addressed to the former Muslim Ummah, the Ahlul Kitab, the people of the book. أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا نَصِيبًا مِنَ الْكِتَابِ. We can go over these ayat hastily, because these things have been discussed in detail in Surah Al-Baqarah. All these things. It's a very rapid repetition. أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا نَصِيبًا مِنَ الْكِتَابِ. Have you not considered the case of those who were given a portion of the book? The book was complete. A portion of it was Torah. A portion of it was Injil. And now the total book has come in the form of Quran. So actually the book, a part of it was given to them. أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا نَصِيبًا مِنَ الْكِتَابِ يَشْتَرُونَ الضَّلَالَةَ. They are purchasing falsehood. وَيُرِيدُونَ أَن تَضِلُّوا السَّبِيلَ. They are themselves purchasing falsehood for them. And they want that you should also go away and astray from the right path. ہم تو ڈوبے ہیں سلم تم کو بھی لے ڈوبیں گے. If we are condemned, you should also be condemned. If we are doomed, let yourself be doomed also. وَاللَّهُ عَالَمُ بِعَدَائِكُمْ. And oh Muslims, Allah very well knows your enemies. They are your enemies. They want to take you astray from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are bent upon misleading you. وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ وَلِيًّا وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ نَصِيرًا. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sufficient as a protector. He is sufficient as a helper. Don't fear them. They will be doing their maximum. They will do their utmost to harm you, but they will not be able to harm you because Allah is your protector. مِنَ الَّذِينَ هَادُوا يُحَرِّفُونَ الْكَلِمَ عَنْ مَوَاضِعِهِ. From among these people who have become Jews are those who pervert words out of their context. وَيَقُولُونَ سَمِعْنَا وَعَصَيْنَا. And they say, we have listened and we have disobeyed. Actually, they imitated as if they are saying سَمِعْنَا وَعَطَعْنَا. But they used to say سَمِعْنَا وَعَصَيْنَا. Oh Muhammad, we have listened and we just reject it. وَسْمَعْ غَيْرَ مُسْمَعِينَ. And listen. And you may not be made to listen. غَيْرَ مُسْمَعِينَ. وَرَاعِنَا لَيَّنًا بِأَلْسِنَتِهِمْ. And they call رَاعِنَا, but they twist their tongues, you know. رَاعِنَا. رَاعِنَا means, oh, our herdsman. And رَاعِنَا means, look to us. Give us concessions. As if we say, pardon me. Please say it again. So this is the, you know, word, social word. But they used to twist the tongue and say رَاعِنَا. وَطَعْنًا فِي الدِّينِ. And slandering in religion. وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ قَالُوا سَمِعْنَا وَاتَعْنَا. Had they said سَمِعْنَا وَاتَعْنَا. We have listened and we obey. We accept. وَاسْمَعْ. And had they said, listen please. Listen, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Please listen to me also. وَانْظُرْنَا. And look to us, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Regard us also. كَانَ خَيْرَ اللَّهُمْ. This would have been much better for them. وَلَاكِنْ لَعْنَهُمُ اللَّهُ بِكُفْرِهِمْ. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has cursed them due to their unbelief, because they have denied the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now they are the accursed ones. They have been cursed. وَلَا يُؤْمِنُونَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. And they are not going to believe except only a very few among them. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ. O you who were given the book, آمِنُوا بِمَا نَزَّلْنَا مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا مَعَكُمْ. Have faith, believe in what we have sent down, and which is confirming that which is with you, Torah. مِنْ قَبْلِ أَن نَطْمِسَ وُجُوهًا. Before that time that we alter your figures, we obliterate your figures, فَنَرُدَّهَا عَلَىٰ أَدْبَارِهَا. And we turn your faces towards the backs. أَوْ لَنْ عَلَهُمْ. Or we curse them. كما لعنا أصحاب السبت, as we had cursed the Sabbath breakers. The whole story has come in Surah Al-Baqarah also, in brief, and it will come in Surah Al-Araf in detail. A tribe of Jews who broke the Sabbath law, and they were made into pigs and monkeys. Their figures were changed. That was the punishment that came to them. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَعَنَهُمْ كَمَا لَعَنَّا أَصْحَابَ السَّبْتِ وَكَانَ أَمْرُ اللَّهِ مَفْعُولًا. And the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has always been executed. And it will be executed now also. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرَ يُشْرَكَ بِهِ. Verily, Allah will never pardon if someone is associated with him. This is the biggest crime, unpardonable. وَيَغْفَرُ مَا دُونَ ذَٰلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. And he will forgive and pardon the lesser than that, for whomsoever he likes. It's not an open license that you can do any other sin. It will be pardoned. No, not open license. But Allah gives us the hope that all the other sins can be pardoned and forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But this shirk, associating someone, declaring someone to be equal to Allah, to be partner to with Allah, in any respect, unpardonable. وَمَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ افْتَرَى إِثْمًا عَظِيمًا. And whosoever does shirk with Allah, associate partners with Allah, so he has forged a mighty sin. أَلَمْ تَرَى إِلَى الَّذِينَ يُزَكُّونَ أَنفُسَهُمْ. Have you not considered those who think they are very pure? They think we are the chosen people of the Lord. Whole of the rest of the mankind, they are Gentiles. They are like cattle. They are like animals, goyims. We are human beings. أَلَمْ تَرَى إِلَى الَّذِينَ يُزَكُّونَ أَنفُسَهُمْ بَلِ اللَّهُ يَزَكِّي مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَلَا يُزْلَمُونَ فَتِيلًا. It is Allah who purifies whomsoever He likes. That is why we should pray to Allah, اللَّهُمَّ زَكِّي نَفْسِي فَإِنَّكَ خَيْرُ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. Oh Allah, purify my soul. You are the best who can purify the souls of people. Allahu yuzakki man yasha. Man yasha can go both ways. Whomsoever Allah likes to purify, and whomsoever himself likes to be purified. Man yasha. Whosoever likes to be purified, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will purify his soul. He will have to do something, some labor he will have to undertake. But you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises he will yuzakki. Wala yuzlamuna fatila, and they will not be wronged. No injustice will be done to them. Even equal to what is fatil. There are two views. The husk round the date stone. Or there is a small thread in the cleft of the date stone. Very small thing. La yuslamuna fatila. Allah is not going to do any injustice to any person. Even equal to that husk round the date stone. Or equal to that small thread which is in the long cleft of the dead stone. انظر كيف يفترون على الله الكذب. Look, O Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how they are forging lies against Allah. This is forging lies against Allah. When they said, لن تنصن النار إلا أياما معدودة. Fire cannot touch us except only a few days, numbered days. This is a forgery against Allah. Allah has never said so. انظر كيف يفترون على الله الكذب وكفى بالله اسما مبينا. And كفى به اسما مبينا. This is sufficient to be a very clear sin. If you are forging something and saying something, attributing it to Allah when Allah has not said so, this is the biggest sin. ألم ترى إلى الذين أوتوا نصيبا من الكتاب يؤمنون بالجبت والطاغوت. Have you not considered those who were given a portion of the book? And they believe in sorcery. And they believe in taghut. What is taghut? Taghut is from tagha. Whosoever is in rebellion against Allah. Everybody has to bow before Allah, has to obey Allah, has to worship Allah. Anybody, any institution which is doing against it. Contravening is taghut. It can be the state. the non-Islamic state, an Islamic state, in which there is the sovereignty of the people, while the sovereignty rests with Allah alone. Sarwari zeba faqat us zaat be hamta ko hai, hukmara hai ek wohi, baqi mutade azri. Sovereignty belongs to him. Now if we declare I am sovereign or we are sovereign, we are taghut. So they are believing in taghut. They are making friendship with taghut. They are making friendship with sorcerers. Yuminuna bi tibta wa taghut wa yaquluna lil ladina kafaru. And they are saying about those who have rejected the deen of Allah from among the mushrikeen. The Jews used to say these mushriks of Makkah, they are better guided than these Muslims. That was, you know, the arrogance. They are better. The idol worshippers, they are better. Kafaru haulai ahda min allazina amanu sabila. They are more guided on the right path than these people who believe in Muhammad and Quran. Ulaika allazina la'anahumullah. These are the people whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has cursed. They had the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already. وَمَنْ يَنْعَلِ اللَّهُ فَلَنْ تَجَدَ لَهُ نَصِيرًا. And whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala curses, you will not be able to find any helper for him. أَمْ لَهُمْ نَصِيبٌ مِنَ الْمُلْكِ. Have they got any share in the sovereignty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? فَإِذَا لَا يُوتُونَ النَّاسَ إِلَّا نَقِيرًا. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them any share in the authority, they will not give to any human being even the least of the things. Now what is naqir? Naqira is a very small speck on the back of the date stone. Now these words are taken from Arabic language, and you know the Arabic language had the vocabulary, basic vocabulary from their own environment. You know, this date tree, that was very crucial to them. The fruit and everything, you know, they are the biggest source of energy for them. This was the date. Now you have the date and there is a stone in it. And there is a very fine, you know, wrapping round the stone. And there is a very small thread in the long cleft of the date stone. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken these words to denote something very trivial, very minor, very small, very ignorable. So for that is naqir and fatil. وَلَا يُزْلَبُونَ فَتِيلًا وَلَا يُوتُونَ النَّاسَ نَقِيرًا. They will not give even a speck, even a small thing to anybody else. They are so miserly. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them the control and the sovereignty, they won't give to anybody, any other person, even a speck. أَمْ يَحْسُدُونَ النَّاسَ. Very crucial. Are they jealous of the people? Why? They were jealous of the Muslims. Why? They were deposed from the position they held for 2,000 years. And that position was given to Muslims. The direction in prayer was changed from Baitul Maqdis to Baitullah in Makkah. A new ummah round a new center. So they were jealous. They were bitter about it. Am yahsudun an-nas? Are they jealous of the people? They are jealous on what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them, the Muslims, from His bounty. فَقَدْ آتَيْنَا آلَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَآتَيْنَاهُمْ مُلْكًا عَظِيمًا. We have given the progeny of Ibrahim the book, the wisdom, and very big kingdom. Now this is very noteworthy. آلَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ includes the progeny of Ismail and the progeny of Ishaq and Yaqub. Both are Ala Ibrahim. Ismail, the grandfather of the Quraysh, the pagan Arabs, Ismail, he was son of Ibrahim, alayhi salatu wassalam. And these Jews, these Bani Israel, they were the sons of Yaqub, who was the grandson of Ibrahim through Ishaq, alayhi salatu wassalam. So this is the progeny. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave one branch of the progeny of Ibrahim, the book, the hikmah, for 2,000 years. Now he has given again to the progeny of Ibrahim. Ismail was also the son of Ibrahim. فَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا آلَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَآتَيْنَاهُمْ مُلْكًا عَظِيمًا. This precious thing has not gone out of the progeny of Ibrahim. It is still The custodians are the progeny of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam. Wabulkan azima, and very big kingdoms. You know, the kingdom of Hazrat Dawood, David and Solomon. The kingdoms which Allah gave to the Arabs. At what time? For several hundred years. They were the greatest power on the earth. Starting from Khilafat Rashida and ending with the end of the dynasty of Banu Abbas, the Arabs, they were dominant over the whole, we will say the greater part of the world. Whole of north of Africa, the biggest chunk of Asia, and you know, all these things were under them. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ آمَنَ بِهِ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ صَدَّ عَنْ From among them there are people who have come to believe in it. Although they were very few. Abdullah ibn Salam, radiyallahu ta'ala an, he was a Jew, very knowledgeable Jew. He believed in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ آمَنَ بِهِ There are a few from among them who have come to believe. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ صَدَّ عَنْهُ And there are others who have held themselves back from it. صَدَّ يَسُدُّ To hold yourself back or to hold someone else also from accepting something. It goes both ways. وَكَفَى بِجَهَنَّمَ سَعِيرًا And for them, the Jahannam, this fire of hell, will be sufficient to burn them. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِآيَاتِنَا Verily those who deny our ayat, refuse to accept them, سَوْفَ نُسْلِيهِمْ نَارًا Very soon we shall cast them into the fire. كُلَّمَا نَضِجَتْ جُلُودُهُمْ Whenever their skins will be burnt off, بَدَّلْنَاهُمْ جُلُودًا غَيْرَهَا We shall give them new skins, لَيَزُوقُوا So that they continue to have the taste of burning. Now this is a very big scientific fact given over here. The sense, the only is in the skin. To the perception of hotness, bitterness, all these things, not throughout the body. The skins have the buds. The taste buds, you know, in our mouth, and there are the sense endings, sensory perception here. So if the skin is gone, now if you are cutting the other tissues, the person is not feeling any pain. So if the skin has gone, this burning of fire will not be painful to them now. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them new skins so that this sense of burning, this, you know, this goes on and on and on and continuous. كُلَّمَا نَضِجَتْ جُلُودُهُمْ بَدَّلْنَاهُمْ جُلُودًا غَيْرَهَا لِيَذُوقُوا الْعَذَابِ So that they continue to taste this punishment. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَزِيزًا حَكِيمًا Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all powerful, all authority and all wise, total wisdom. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ In the contrast, because the people of the fire were mentioned, now the believers, what will be their lot? وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ And those who believe, who have the real faith, and the proof of their real faith is عَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ They do good deeds. If there is real faith, real iman, real conviction, your character will be transformed. Your whole attitude in life will tell that this person believes in Allah. This person really believes in Muhammad. This person really believes in Quran. He really believes in the hereafter and resurrection. He really believes in the fire of hell and in the paradise. So actually your attitude, your actions, your deeds, they show whether you really believe or not. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ سَنُدْخِلُهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ Very soon we shall make them enter. The gardens underneath which rivers will be flowing. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا أَبَدًا They will abide there forever, forever. لَهُمْ فِيهَا أَزْوَاجٌ مُطَهَّرَةٌ For them there will be pure and clean wives. وَنُدْخِلُهُمْ ظِلًّا ظَلِيلًا And we shall make them enter into very thick shades, very cool and very thick shades. بَارَكَ اللَّهُ لِي وَلَكُمْ فِي الْقُرْآنِ الْعَظِيمِ وَنَفَعْنِي وَإِيَّاكُمْ بِالْآيَاتِ مَصْدِقِ الْحَكِيمِ
الله أكبر
The Islamic Organization of North America, IONA, is an organization dedicated to reviving the Quran into the hearts of Muslims while bringing its message to non-Muslims. The obligations of a Muslim as ordained by the Quran and Sunnah can be understood as having four levels. 1. A Muslim is required to develop real faith and conviction, iman, in one's heart. 2. A Muslim is required to live a life of complete submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 3. A Muslim is required to propagate and disseminate the message of Islam to humanity as a whole. 4. A Muslim is required to try his utmost in establishing the just Islamic order. The first and foremost objective of establishing IONA is to assist the Muslims in North America to uphold and implement these obligations, first on themselves, their families, inform their friends, and then to invite the non-Muslims to Islam. The ultimate goal is to seek Allah's pleasure and salvation in the hereafter. For more information about IONA, please visit us at www.tanzeem.us. You may also email us at info@tanzeem.us or call our toll-free number 866-779-IONA. Join us. Together we can make a difference.